puppetry. In trying to figure out how I want to start a talk about puppetry today, I realize we all know what puppets are, but not everyone knows what it means to perform one. So what do? I look in Webster's, and I was a little disappointed. Because Webster's defines puppetry as to bring life to an inanimate object not inherent to its own mechanism. It's a really highfalutin way of looking at puppetry, because basically what it means is moving an object in a way it can't normally move. So this puppet right here is in a neutral position. I am now bringing life to that inanimate object. That's a very academic, scholarly, boring way to look at things. Puppeteers have a much more romantic view on what puppetry is and what it can be. We like to brag that puppetry is the all-inclusive art form because it draws on a lot of individual disciplines in order to find its success. The puppet alone is a work of sculpture. It's kinetic sculpture in the round. But to get to this point, you need to have a lot of design work. You need to be able to do a lot of illustrations and making sure that that's the character you want to build. And then you need to be a craftsman, be able to put it in three dimensions from the 2D page. Once you get to this point, you need to be able to bring it to life, which means movement and dance, acting and singing. And it also helps to be able to manipulate your voice in a way to give your character its own distinct sound. Frog in my throat, sorry. More on him later. And then we get to my third and favorite part of puppetry, is the story. Being able to take this character that you've created and put it in an environment to give an audience exposition, climax, and resolution. We're spoiled today because we get our story from a lot of different places, Facebook and YouTube and Hulu and television and all this stuff. We get it from our computers and our iPads, laptops, iPhones. Before all this, we got it from televisions, and dare I say, we were even spoiled by books. Because before we got an illustrated storybook, we had puppets tell our stories, illustrate our stories, and bring them to life. Some people don't realize this, but the art of puppetry is almost as old as storytelling itself. It dates back to civilizations and families gathering around a fire and passing on canon from one generation to the next, whether it be historical, fictional, religious, or whatever. And it's in the same really rich tradition that puppeteers continue today, to move your audiences both emotionally and affectionately. And that's what I want to talk about today. Good storytelling and puppetry. Now, at this point, I want to point out the elephant in the room. or because it's puppetry, maybe the snuffleupagus in the room. It's very difficult to talk about puppetry, at least in a contemporary setting, at least in America, without also talking about the Muppets. They've kind of become the gold standard by which we judge a lot of our contemporary puppetry. And there's a very good reason for this. The Muppets did a lot of things right. Jim Henson and Frank Oz and the guys who created it back in the 50s. But so much of what made the Muppets successful is what made puppetry that came before them successful. Because the Muppets are kind of just the next line in a very long lineage of successful puppet performers. So in talking today about puppetry and kind of the big thing, I'm going to talk about it through the focus of the Muppet characters. I feel more comfortable talking about it. I think we all kind of have a better sense of who the Muppets are. And then we can begin to extrapolate it and see how it can apply to Muppets, original Muppet characters. I myself am a pretty big Muppet fan, because I think anyone who knows me in the room would know. And I right now I'm actually 21 years old. This is a birthday. I don't know what makes me a bigger nerd, that I have Oscar the Grouch on my birthday cake, or that Oscar is orange as he was in the very first season of Sesame Street. But now, 4 months later, I am 21 years, 4 months old, which means I've been a Muppet fan for about 22 years and 1 month, if I had added the 9 properly. I'm not sure, it's been a while since I was a math major. But a story that I grew up hearing was, in all seriousness, the first experience I ever had with a Muppet. And I'd like to share that with you today because it really illustrates a nice point about the magnetism that these characters have and how they can affect our audiences. So, the year was 1991. Little Pam Garrity was about 4 or 5 months old. And my mom and my grandparents wanted to take me to the ball for the very first time with the Garrity mom. And it's important to know that I am my parents' oldest child, and on my mom's side, I'm the oldest grandkid. So taking a newborn baby anywhere was a pretty fresh experience for everyone involved, as I'm sure you can imagine. But things were going pretty well for a while. You know, I got some new clothes, tried some new food. But then an hour into the trip, my mom and my grandma went off somewhere, probably to the bathroom, and I was left alone with my grandfather. What do you do with a new baby? But you take him to the toy store. So we're walking around, and the instant our stroller passes the threshold of the KB Toys, I began to cry. I was screaming. I was going downright ape. we couldn't figure it out. So my grandfather did probably what any new grandfather would do, hadn't dealt with a baby for 25 years. He starts grabbing every toy off the shelf he could find until one would eventually shut me up. So he tried a lot of different things, teddy bears, stuffed animals, rattles. When he tells the story, he says he was even so desperate as to try a Barbie doll. Fortunately, that did not work, or else this would be a completely different presentation. But finally, we made our way to the Sesame Street section, and he pulled off this Big Bird doll from the shelf. The instant I got that thing in my arms, I was quiet. I was silent. I was downright content. And that instant, I had made my new best friend. Shortly after that, I began talking. After the obligatory first words of Dada, a very close second was Da-Doy, which meant Big Bird. Eventually, I found out that the performer of Big Bird, Carol Spinney, he also performs Oscar on Sesame Street, him and I share a birthday, and to me, that's just like the coolest thing ever. Muppet nerd. Anyway, quick story about him. He has been performing Big Bird and Oscar since day one on Sesame Street. He's 77 years old now, and at this point, he only visits Sesame Street about 4 or 5 days a season to do some minor filming. He has a lot of understudies. When I was visiting Sesame Street last year, I was lucky enough to be there on one of Carol's days, and I was able to share some of the story with him while sitting at Hooper's store. To this day, I'm sure it's no question or argument, Da-Doy remains my favorite all-time Muppet. I'm gonna take this through the water real quick. So I guess my question, after talking about this, is how? How do the Muppets draw us in year after year after year? What makes their magnetism? And after a lot of research, a lot of reading, a lot of TV viewing, I've narrowed it down to two big points. The first is that the Muppets are real. Now, I don't mean this in any kind of weird schizophrenic way, but it's true, the Muppets are real, they are physical, they are tactile. You can reach out and touch them. This fact alone registers with us as an audience, at least on some sort of subliminal level. You know, we're able to kind of all sit back and exhale, you know, take that sigh of relief that we're seeing something that hasn't spent hours in the render farm on the Pixar campus. By those same standards, though, that means that Barney could also be real. And I don't think anyone has ever taken a sigh of relief when they watch Barney on television. So there's an added component to this. Let's review a social script for a second. If you were to have a conversation with someone, what do? You sit down, you look at them in the eye, you talk back and forth for a while, and at the end of the conversation, you either shake their hand or give them a hug, depending on how well you know the person. You can do this with a Muppet. You know, if Kermit the Frog was in here in the room, you can have a conversation with him. Now, granted, there'd be like a 6-foot-tall man under the table, and that'd get a little weird. But after that initial shock, you know, you could sit down with him and look him in the eye. He would look back. You could say something to him. He would be able to respond. And at the end of that conversation, he would be open-armed, ready to give you a hug. Elmo, by contrast, only shakes hands. I learned that part. Another bad joke. We've all seen the Today Show, yes? So we all know that the concept of the Today Show, for the most part, is for celebrities to come on, plug whatever program or TV show they're doing, and then we go out to the theater and buy their product or whatever. So when Toy Story, let's just speak in hypotheticals. If Toy Story 4 was going to come out next month, who would sit on the Today Show couch with Matt Lauer? Would it be Buzz Lightyear? Or would it be Tim Allen?
Tim Allen.
Yeah. Because Tim Allen is the celebrity. You know, he is the person who voices Buzz Lightyear, who brings him to life. If Buzz Lightyear was there, it would seem very stiff. In the same way that we all exhale when we see a real Muppet, if we see a 3D character in our space, we kind of take a step back because we know, at least on that subliminal level, that it's not real. I'm going to stop picking on Pixar because I really do love the characters. So we're going to go to Pirates of the Caribbean. God forbid we were ever going to get another Pirates of the Caribbean. Who would sit on the couch? Would it be Captain Jack Sparrow or would it be Johnny Depp?
Johnny Depp.
Thank you. Because Johnny Depp is the actor. When Pirates of the Caribbean, whatever movie it is, when that ends, when the credits finally roll, we have closure for Jack Sparrow, at least until the next movie. Johnny Depp is the actor. Johnny Depp is the person you could ask and say, you know, how much of a diva is Keira Knightley on set? He is the hardworking, trained actor who brings the fiction to life. Now, using this exact same logic, when the Muppet movie came out last November, we would have all been really, really excited to see Eric Jacobson on the couch, right? No one's ever heard? Oh, that's strange. Oh, Matt Vogel? Phil Beretta? David Rudman? Of course not, because no one cares who David Rudman is except me and that guy who's a Muppet fan, and maybe David Rudman's mother. You know, we don't care how hard it was for Steve Whitmire to keep his arm up in the air. We want Steve Whitmire sewn into the Today Show couch with his arm through the cushion, performing Kermit the Celebrity, so we could ask him the questions about how much of a diva is Miss Piggy on set. And this is crazy. We care as a society about the love life of a green sock. But that's what they want. You know, that is the magic of the Muppets. The Muppets give us an excuse to believe in a fantasy that coexists in our real world. And that is really powerful. Connecting this to, again, the larger puppetry. It's like a Kermit the Puppet. Anyway, I don't know how true or not this is, but this is an old puppet legend. A couple hundred years ago, there was a king who lived in this land, and he had certain gestures and performers come and perform right in front of him. And one day, this one puppeteer came to perform for the king, did political satires, and completely ripped the king a new you-know-what. This was also in an area where political satire was punishable by death. When the king took out his sword, ready to... The puppeteer said, "Whoa, wait, it wasn't me, the puppet said it." And the man went off scot-free, the puppet was destroyed. So, that gives you a good feel for what we're working with. Anyway, so let's move on to step two about the power of the Muppets. To watch the Muppets is to become a Muppet. Now, again, I don't mean this in any kind of weird way, but who has seen the original Muppet movie from 1976? All right. For those of you who raised your hand and don't really remember, or for those of you who didn't see the movie, you would know that the movie does not start with Kermit on the banjo singing the Rainbow Connection in a swamp. It starts with all of the Muppets gathering together in a movie theater to watch that movie with you. In those 5 minutes of an establishing shot, you sit down with Kermit and his nephew Robin and Piggy and Fozzie and Gonzo, and you get to see the world through their black and white googly eyes. You get to become a Muppet with them. This also happened on a weekly basis with The Muppet Show. You know, this is a picture of the Muppet Show audience. There's not a single human in there. You have to fill in those seats as you watch at home. So you get to see all the crazy antics of any of the characters. Returning back to Sesame Street. I have not seen all 4,344 episodes of Sesame Street. I I'm just not a big enough fan. But of the episodes that I have seen, they've all started a little something like this. Hi there, welcome to Sesame Street. I'm Ernie. Rubber Ducky and I were just about to have a play date together. Hey, do you want to join us? Well, grab your pretend rubber ducky and we'll all have a play date together. Something like that. A lot more where that came from. Again, the Muppets, you know, not only do we accept them into our space, the Today Show, the Oscars, you know, Martha Stewart's Kitchen, but they also invite us into their space. It's a continual give and take. We're there to learn from each other and to teach each other. We're there to teach each other how to laugh. You know, how to sing, how to dance, how to time a joke, and how to take criticism from that joke. How to rock out, man. How to perform death-defying stunts. We learn from the Muppets how to fall in love, and subsequently how not to fall in love.
That's not the way to do it.
You know, we learn friendship from these guys. We learn what it means to cope with death, and how to live in spite of that death. Ladies and gentlemen, it's really, really easy to write off the Muppet characters as, you know, just socks, just ping pong balls. But it's a hell of a lot easier to just accept the reality that these characters can play in our lives. You know, the magic and the power of these characters. You know, right down to tucking your four-month-old kid in bed at night with the new Big Bird doll that your dad got him at the mall and realize that they can have a real, lasting, sustainable impact that can, you know, make good people, I guess. And that is the power of Puppetry. So, at this point, I'm going to stop talking, at least for a little bit, and have the puppet characters come out and do their thing. More water. Before I do that, though, I would like to show you, this is how one of the characters you're going to be seeing. This is Scrap, a character of my own make and model. And Scrap here, my right hand is in here in the mouth, performing the head. And then my left arm hand is performing the rods, similar to chopsticks. So I can only perform this character. If I wanted to have a second puppet character in an act, it would automatically become impossible. I would need four arms. I would need to learn how to clone myself. Fortunately for you all here today, I have done just that. Thanks to an invention of my own making called the PRSVP, otherwise known as the pre-recorded self-contained virtual puppet. I'm going to move the podium quickly because I think it'll be in the way of a few people. Can you see the screen?
Yes.
To be an entertainer. The
show that makes somebodies out of nobodies and dreams into realities. My name is Kermit the Frog, and we have a wonderful show planned for you today. Watch us now as we change the life of one monster who wants nothing more than to work in television. Let's bring him out here now, ladies and gentlemen. It's James on Scrapletter. Yay!
Thanks so much. Thank you, Kermit, but you can just call me Scrap. Yes, Scrap.
Okay, well then, let's get a move on, shall we? I have devised a three-step plan that is guaranteed to make you adorned by millions of people all over the world.
Where do we start?
I'm glad you asked that. Get an agent.
Hey.
The only way you can get your foot in the door is by having someone to tell you where you can find that door. We call those people agents.
Like secret spy agents?
No, Scrap. An agent is a person on your team who has all kinds of connections with other people who are already in the film industry.
They give direction when you don't know where to go next.
Exactly.
Well, I already have that.
You do?
Sure, right here on my iPhone. Siri, how do I get on the Big Bang Theory?
Wait, stop. The Big Bang Theory?
Sure, I love that show.
I don't think they're really looking for any new cast members, Scrap. Besides, you don't really fit the part there.
You bet I do. What do you call a nerd who wears glasses?
You can't just replace human interaction with a cell phone.
Siri, from now on, I'm going to be your client.
This is all wrong.
Siri, find me a good acting job.
See, you didn't even get your answer right to your question. I told you this plan was going to fail.
Yeah. Siri, how do I get rid of Kermit the Frog?
I'm sorry I ever questioned you, Scrap.
That's okay.
I guess we can let Siri be your agent.
All right, step two.
Here we go. It's time to get a theme song. It's time to pick one now.
A theme song? Isn't picking one up presumptuous? I don't even have a TV show yet.
I know it seems a little strange, especially since most networks have removed theme songs from their programming altogether. But we had most of the jokes written in advance anyway, so why let them go to waste?
You're the boss, boss. Do you have any in mind?
You bet. We have some right here.
Okay.
Let me just change this here for a second. And here we go. Very good. And music!
Oh, boy. Kermit, just stop right there. What are you doing? Kermit?
This happens to be a very classic theme song, Scrap.
You're in black and white.
Oh, come on. You know, just because I'm not in color does not diminish the
Choose
overall quality.
Choose a new song, Frog.
What about this?
Oh, boy. Come on, move it along. This isn't going to work. No one in prime time respects the children's entertainment industry.
Well, I suppose that's true. You know, after my brief time spent at Sesame Street News, I never was let back on Meet the Press.
Yeah, well, what about music for a hard-hitting drama that cuts to a deep truth about the human condition?
You know what? I think I have just what you're looking for. How about this?
No, forget it. I will not do murder mysteries, nothing with guns. I am too young to die.
You know, Scrap, if you're going to be successful, you're going to need to make some compromises. Not everything can happen the way you want them to.
You're right, Kermit.
Okay, great.
Step three!
You beat me to it there.
Yeah.
Well, you know, there's an old theater adage that goes, it's not what you know, it's who you know. Knowing that, we're going to find a celebrity to endorse you, James on Scrapletter, in order to set your acting career off like a rocket.
Great! Who do you have for me?
Oh, well, let me just change the channel to PBS. Hi there! Welcome to Sesame Street. I'm Ernie. Rubber Ducky and I were just about to have a play date together. Hey, would you like to join us?
Wait, stop. Ernie!
Yup?
Kermit said I was supposed to meet a celebrity who could jumpstart my acting career. You're not supposed to be that person, are you?
Nuh-uh. But I'll give you a clue who is.
Swimsuit wedges.
Stop it.
Oh, what are the odds? Rainbow and I love it here.
I'm sorry, Scrap. I was trying to tell you that wouldn't work. The only person those videos have ever fooled is Steve Carell.
I knew that joke wasn't funny.
Yeah,
Herbert, what am I gonna do?
Well, I'm kind of a celebrity.
Of course, that's right. You were just in that movie with Jason Segel.
Right.
Do you think I can meet him?
No. But I do work for the Walt Disney Company. And when you work for Disney, there isn't a channel they won't let you on.
Oh.
Well, except Fox News. But I don't mind anyways. Those guys are a bunch of...
Oh! It seems I stepped on the mute button. I wonder if there's another channel with someone who could help me become famous. Here.
Clean and sober?
Yes, I'm good. And I'm clean and sober.
Hey, everybody! I'm in a car with Batman! I have his face all over my underpants!
Come Wednesday morning, they're gonna rename it. Charlie Brothers and not Warner Brothers. Duh. Winnie.
And all these crummy people. It doesn't take any talent to be on TV. Not at all! Anyone could be on TV. In fact,
wow, there we go. I guess I really didn't need Kermit's help after all. Today's show couch, here I come.
Where am I? Buffalo? This is too close to Canada! Scrap! Let me back in! Scrap!
Designing a storyboard. This could easily become an animated movie, an illustrated book. Hopefully, it will become a work of puppet theater. So let me just change this back to where we were before. And it's important to know that the format that the storyboard takes is very similar to what a lot of Pixar artists use in kind of planning out their movies. And actually, it's a fun game to play if you're a movie nerd, to try to plug in key points from a given movie into the outline that I'm about to explain. So, in developing an outline for a story, we begin once upon a time. That's kind of an overrated. And then you fill in the blank. So once upon a time, and every day, until one day, and because of that, and because of that, and because of that, until finally, and since that day, and then we give you the moral of the story. So the storyboard that you're about to see was based on this outline, and it actually stars a little character you might recognize. So we open with Scrap, and he's much younger than the Scrap that you just saw, and he's sitting at night on the couch with his father. And his father is telling him all about the stars and the universe and what the story's about, the constellations and why they were made. And every night, Scrap looks up at the sky and sees the beauty of outer space. Eventually, Scrap loses his father, as most of us do. However, it was before Scrap was ever really to grow up or fall in love or make a family. So years pass and day turns to night, and Scrap is now older, probably the age that you just saw him. And he goes into town every day trying to explain how great the universe is to all kind of the provincial town people. And every day they just kind of look at him with a blank face and really could care less. So every day he brings something more incredible about outer space and what it means, but all he ever gets is a little head scratcher. Every day, Scrap goes back up to his conservatory as the sun is setting. By the time he gets upstairs, he looks out at the sky and sees a star extinguish from the sky because he was not able to share a story with a receptive audience. Scrap is walking into town, his usual morning stroll, and he sees a girl. And this girl is more like him than any other girl he's ever seen before. And he's so awestruck that he stumbles down the street and drops everything, all the contents of his duffel bag. And she helps him up, and she gives him the telescope that he dropped, and she has some interest. It's the first time anyone has ever shown interest in what he also has interest in. And wouldn't you know it, it's the perfect match. So he invites her to his home. And they spend time together looking up at the stars, and he's able to, for the first time, share stories that he used to hear from his father. And for the first time since his father's passing, a star is relit in the sky. Now, this happens every day, every night, and eventually the two become really close friends. And not only do they share things about the stars and outer space, but also just life things, you know, what it means to be a friend, you know, that kind of stuff. And each night, more and more stars are lit up in the sky. Finally, they want to look at kind of the new beautiful canvas that they have created over the months. And they both look out into the sky and realize that it wasn't just friendship that made this, but love. And upon this realization, the last splat of ink is added to the sky, and they're given the moon. And days again turn to night, and they become bolder with children. And they're able to share the story with their kids to pass on to the next generation. And that is my story about Scrap. At this point, I'm open for questions. I do have a camera set up to show you some of how I make the videos and how this stuff works, but before I do, I'd like to open it up to the floor for some discussion.
Not speaking as a visual artist, I'm curious, was the storyboard with the intention of it being animated, or was it always in the back of your head that it might be a live-action puppet thing, or...?
It was intended for an animation class, so I did have it in the back of my mind. You know, maybe... someone at Pixar would find it and want to make a movie out of it. But I did already have Scrap made, so I knew that it could work in sort of a puppet storytelling. And when I found out that they wanted us to bring a script to O'Neill, I was like, perfect. So that's what I wanted to do.
But you find the storyboarding process equally useful for both and the
yes.
same kind of
space? Yes, because it's all just good storytelling. Whatever medium you want to put it in, you need that preliminary step.
When did you make your first puppet?
My first good puppet was in Professor Bearclaw's class in freshman year. But I've been building, you know, putting eyes on socks since I was EA tall. So I guess 3 years ago. I've been doing it for a while. I've been performing for a lot longer. Unfortunately, my hand has gotten too big to fit into a lot of the puppets that you would buy at a toy store. So I'd like to say I build from necessity, but performing is what I really enjoy doing more than anything.
Yes. Where do you see yourself in the future, 10, 20 years from now?
Well, the nervous junior who is looking at the real world in graduation says, as long as I can make a living flipping burgers, I'd be okay. The really cocky puppeteer in me says, in 10 years, I'll be working on Sesame Street. If I fall anywhere in the middle, I'll be happy. Kevin.
Can you tell us how you learned how to make the puppets?
How to make the puppets, yes. Well, excuse me. Again, it starts with the sock. And you start to see, if you put your hand in the sock, it really still kind of looks like a hand. Fortunately, there's a really great puppet resource. It's called projectpuppet.com, and they sell a lot of patterns. Actually, scrap is one of those patterns. And once you buy kind of the outline for the character, it's really easy to format it in different ways. Actually, I think pretty much all the puppets on here, except Cookie Monster and Oscar, not mine, were built from that Project Puppet place. I completely taught myself how to sew, and a lot of the design is obviously influenced by Coach and Henson. So, yes?
Could you talk a bit about Avenue Q and how much of the puppets there were yours versus whatever the Broadway people told you to do?
I actually did not build the puppets for Avenue Q. Actually, that's that guy in the back right there. We work together a lot on different things, so I can't quite comment on that. But lost my train of thought there. I think Adam had pretty free range in designing the characters, but you know, trying to make sure you want to keep the character intact. All of these characters sort of have a certain, we call it gestalt. So if you look at a character like Mr. Johnson here, he inherently looks different than our friend Scrap here. So they inherently need to look differently. Excuse me, they inherently look differently, so they're inherently going to have a different kind of character. So working backwards from that, if you have a monster who is addicted to porn, you're probably not going to make him bright pony pink. So they're that kind of thing to think about. What else? Yes?
You mean Kermit? No.
I have made Kermits before. Unfortunately, the arm on my Kermit broke, so he is on loan again from the Avenue Q guy in the back. All right, I do have a camera set up. I can show you sort of how the stuff is done. This is how all the Muppets work, the Muppet performers, how they work. And what I have here, right here, is a TV monitor. And I am seeing exactly, bear with me, I am seeing exactly this picture. So the Muppet performers hold their arms up nice and high, and instead of looking up at the puppet, we actually look down at the camera. So we see exactly what you guys would see at home. There we go. And this is the way we work, so we could constantly be framing what the puppets are doing. Because, you know, if you're an artist or an animator, you are able to determine where the puppets are going to be, or where your animated characters are going to be in the shot. So the puppeteers get the same freedom. So if Kermit needs to be over here, he's over here now, or we're going to move him this way, and there we go. So that's how that works. And then, record it, excuse me. If I could have Zach actually come up for a second. This is a hand rod puppet. It's pretty self-explanatory. My hand is up here while the rods perform the arms. But then we have some crazier things. This is a sack puppet, because you could turn him inside out and basically see all the innards. But he also has two gloves for hands, so live hand puppet. My hand is controlling the left hand and the head, and that here is performing the right hand. So if we're doing this kind of thing, hello everyone. You know, we're just doing stuff here. This is quite sloppy, He has not been briefed on what we're actually doing here. So, and in theory, because Cameron is on this side, Zach would also have a camera down here, but because we don't have the cords, I think you understand. So this is how it works. The other thing, that's a sack puppet. And then sort of the third class of character of the really basic stuff is the live hand. You got a puppet here. And yeah, and as opposed to the sack where we're kind of all under one big thing, again, there's a little more freedom to be able to do what we need to. And then we can just see, you know, he has elbows, which the other characters don't. So that's that. You've probably also been looking at the gigantic orange guy over here. This is a full body character, very much still in process. I did not know in building it quite how difficult it was to blow up a puppet to 300% its normal size. Again, not a math major anymore. So, he got kind of damaged in transit from the trimane. You hold that. All open down here. And these blue things will be on my shoulders. Do I? There we go. So, to be honest, I can't see out of this right now, so I don't know what anyone is seeing. But, you know, we would have arms on here normally. I would also have some way of seeing out. This is poor construction on my part. The guy who does Big Bird has a TV screen, and he would see the same stuff that we're seeing on the monitor. If he's doing a live performance, or if it's something like Sesame Street Live, we'd have a large tie that you could see out of because it's a see-through foam. So that's a full body. Zach, where is your hand? This is why puppeteers don't do work by themselves. So, at this point I'll take a call for any more questions.
I'm going to touch the just a slight effect. Do you find that the skills kind of transfer readily from one to the other, or is that the rods a very, very distinct technique compared to the others?
Well, the rods are different because, here's an example, I call these guys chopsticks. It's the difference between trying to eat food with chopsticks or just eat it all with your hands. You know, these guys are the hamburger, this is the Chinese rice. So, I mean, it's a different kind of thing. Obviously, the hand movement is all the same. This is easier in one sense because you're working alone. As you can kind of see, Zach and I were prepared to work together, so one arm was doing one thing while another was doing another. So these guys are inherently harder because you're working with two people, where this is harder because there's more technical skill in the manipulation.
One other question.
Yes.
So this might be a bit too kind of geeky for everybody else.
No, go ahead. Audience,
but I figure you might have geeky enough and get through it.
Okay.
Do you find yourself watching episodes of Sesame Street or any other show where you kind of, like, there are just certain moments where you see a puppet that's operated by two people and you think, I'm just seeing, like, a real moment of genius on the screen? Or do they all look kind of similar to you because they're all in a similar sort of professional standard?
The circle biking.
What's that?
The circle biking.
The circle biking, right. There's certain things on the Muppets where you kind of watch it and you just say, holy shit, how did they do that? The Kermit on the bicycle is one thing. And actually, you'd be surprised, doing Kermit on a bicycle is, like, really easy in comparison to blowing out a candle. There was a really funny episode of the Muppet Show where there's a candle, I think it was the Vincent Price episode, so there were a lot of demons going around and a lot of candles and, you know, spooky horror stuff. And Kermit is here, there's a candle here, and he just goes and blows it out, turns to the camera and says, think about that one, folks. He doesn't have lungs, you know, there's nothing. This is a flat thing. And when you see stuff like that, they did the same thing in the new Muppet movie. Kermit switches a match. And the first time I saw the movie, I lost my breath. Because, again, to get these things, to do anything, to pick up anything, it's impossible to get that. I can't light a match. let alone to do it with Rod, is very important. So there are some things, yes, that you just work in control and abilities. And those are probably takes that they spend the whole day trying to work on. Those guys are geniuses, but so much of it is just because they're more dedicated. It's not because anyone can't do it, it's just because they aren't willing to put the time into doing it.
How much, I'm curious, and this it might be another little too technical question. I'm curious, and especially with the, kind of the history of Jim Henson and Frank Oz and that crowd.
Yeah.
How much was there overlap between sort of the producing, directing, puppeteering? Like, did these guys set up their own shots and then climb into the puppets and work them through, or were they very sort of separated, like traditional television?
I don't know, because Jim Henson... got me thinking now, but I don't think Jim Henson, he did direct a feature. I don't know how that worked. Certainly there are co-directors involved, but Jim Henson was very much involved with every stage of the process. Certainly it's somewhat easier because they always have the monitors, so it's not the instance of, I was talking with one of the theater professors yesterday, and he was saying Orson Welles, they have to set up the entire shot and then move into and take his place, whereas if Kermit is... Or, excuse me, Jim Henson was directing with Kermit here, you know, he's already in the trenches, so to speak. So there's a bit of an ease, but, you know, he was in every stage of the process.
Well, just because you're talking about, like, so important, unlike the Bunraku stuff we saw today, where you're kind of masked, mm-hmm. and if you're seen, it doesn't matter.
Right.
Like, so much of this is about functioning within the frame.
Right.
I think about, like, sort of Jackie Chan setting up his own shots in order to best... focus on the stuff that he knows is going to happen in there.
Right.
And like to think that the puppeteers would have sort of the best idea about framing things when, like move tracking shots, which must have been a nightmare.
They certainly would, but Jim Henson also had, there's a lot of people on Jim Henson's team who you rarely hear about. I mean, that's inherent with any kind of puppetry, but you hear a name like Faz Bazakas, and he was responsible for the doozers on Fraggle Rock. I don't know if anyone, they were like really tiny, intricate characters. But Foz was with them from the early days of the Muppet Show. He got Fozzie's ears to wiggle. You know, he probably had something to do with Kermit blowing out the candle. He was certainly there, you know, getting rats to ice skate on butter on a grill in Muppet Save Manhattan. So there's a whole creative team that would be working just on the technical stuff, and they knew how all of this worked, and Jim Henson was kind of just managing everything, playing
As a fellow art major, I'm not sure what you're doing for your senior project. You planned a feature?
I do not know. Again, I'm graphic design, so certainly part of that needs to be incorporated. Again, with the conference that I'll be going to, I'd really like to incorporate this kind of stuff in it, but I don't know. I'm kind of waiting to finish today before I start thinking about that. You'll definitely be seeing puppets incorporated somewhere. Yeah.
Any new one named Puppet for now?
Excuse me?
Any new movie Puppet? Are you really good?
I do a lot of stuff on YouTube. Again, this guy and the guy in the back, and we get together and we'll set up a shot like this. We'll have maybe 30 so puppets set up in a basement, and we'll just kind of switch them out and put them on and just do a lot of improvising. That then may be translated if we find a little nugget that's just pure gold. We'll refine it and make it a real sketch. We have a lot of stuff on YouTube, though. The Cameron Group, if you're interested. All one word.
Thank you.
No? All right. Well, thank you again, everyone. I really appreciate it.